All right, this morning, I'm going to help us see differently a little bit. If you've got your bulletin, on the inside of that bulletin, there's the 10 of our code. I'm going to look at the last four today, all right? But what we're about this morning is kind of seeing a little bit differently, maybe being challenged just a little bit, and I'll share kind of the way I've personally been challenged. If you look at those last four, we're dealing with diversity and unity and justice and grace and truth. And I've had the privilege of teaching a class hybrid called Generous Justice, kind of a new model we're going to do with some of our groups over time, where some groups get together and kind of work through some content together. But in that class hybrid, kind of based on a book by Tim Keller called Generous Justice, it's really challenged me personally to see things differently, especially in some areas of justice and unity and diversity. I grew up Greenwood, South Side, okay, and grew up for the most part where everybody looked about like I did, probably better looking, but, you know, kind of grew up where not a lot of diversity, all right? The diversity I tended to see was on the other side of a football field, okay? So for the most part, didn't come in contact with much diversity, didn't come in contact with a lot of poverty, okay? Thoroughly middle class, kind of thought the way I thought and the world as I saw it. I mean, I guess how that's how we all think the way we grow up is kind of natural and right and all that. And then had the opportunity to teach in the classroom at a big school on the west side, an urban school, where I was kind of challenged to think differently and learned a lot about poverty and diversity and unity and some of these things kind of from an educational perspective. All right, I had done a lot of reading, had an opportunity to coach and teach all different types of kids, different types of backgrounds, and was really blessed by that. But what I probably didn't have at that time was a kind of spiritual, biblical understanding of that. All right? And going through this course, reading the book, being able to share some stuff, it's really challenged me in the way really grace is at the core of who God is. Grace is at the core of our relationship to Him. And grace is really at the core of how we interact with all types of people. And I want to share a little bit of how I've been challenged kind of through through that book and some other stuff. And I want to do that really by looking at a parable that's pretty familiar to a lot of us, okay, maybe new to you. But we're going to look at the parable of the Good Samaritan, all right? We're going to look at our kind of our attitude a little bit, our thinking, and how that might change by looking at the parable. Okay, real quick, I want to give you a definition of attitude because I want you to kind of shine the light on your attitude this morning, all right? Shine the light on my attitude. But attitude is a settled way of thinking or feeling about someone or something that is reflected in one's actions. Attitude is how we see, right? It's how we see, how we think, how we feel. Now, let's look at the parable, okay? And I'm gonna go through the parable, give you the story, but I would challenge you to do this. If this is like, okay, I've been there, done that, heard all about the Good Samaritan before, listen, see. Just like Steve said, maybe you'll see something differently as we look at it together this morning. All right, the parable of the Good Samaritan comes from the Gospel of Luke. Okay, Jesus says this, and behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test. Now, real quick, lawyer back in the day, a little bit more of a theologian than lawyer like we think of today, expert in the law, all right? Lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Great question. He said to him, what is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. Lawyer could have, like, given you the whole Old Testament, right? But he summarizes the law in these two commandments. And he said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, somebody who would have helped out the priest, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, okay, ancient conflict, Samaritans, Jews. Jews thought Samaritans were half-breeds because they'd sold out years ago. Jews had destroyed the Samaritan's temple. There was drama. There was conflict, all right? Would have been the villain in the story in a conventional way of thinking. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii, it's like 2 days' wages, and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Had he not done that, the man would have become an indentured servant because he couldn't pay the debt. Okay? Which of these three do you think proved to be a neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. Now, there's a lot going on here. Let's talk about it. And I want to suggest that there are really 4 kind of implications, 4 takeaways, 4 ways to kind of challenge our attitude as we reflect on this parable. All right? Now, the first kind of takeaway or the first attitude or the first what it's about is this. Go ahead. Okay. It's about grace and truth. It's about grace and truth. Now, I went quickly through the parable, but as we come back to it just a little bit, I want us to kind of be challenged a little bit. The lawyer puts Jesus to the test. What's that test about? The lawyer was seeking to justify himself. Okay? The lawyer was on a project of saying, I'm good enough, I follow the law, I can save myself. Jesus' response, who's my neighbor? That's the question he's answering, okay? The lawyer, when he says, who is my neighbor? What he's trying to do is take that huge commandment and whittle it down, right? Now think about this. What does it mean to love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength? Can anybody attain that? What does it mean to truly love your neighbor as yourself? Can anybody really attain that? Part of what, and maybe the main thing that Jesus is getting at in the parable, now of course he's going to talk about who's my neighbor and what's it mean to love like a neighbor and all those things, but at the very core, let me challenge you to think about this. Jesus is the great Samaritan. Jesus is the great Samaritan. Now let's think through that a little bit, okay? Picture yourself in the parable. Picture yourself. There is a man lying half dead on the road. Now, the man is not identified. Scholars say that the man was a Jew. The lawyer is a Jew. The lawyer is challenged to think about the man lying half dead on the road. We are challenged to think about the man lying half dead on the road. What Jesus is getting at, the man on the road could be the lawyer, could be me, could be you. What does Jesus do? Jesus comes alongside, picks him up, saves him. In fact, frees him from his potential indentured servanthood or servitude. Jesus is the Great Samaritan. Jesus, as Ephesians 2, 4, 5 says, but God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. Now, I need you to understand this for a minute. Two ways of going about things here. Okay? You can be like the lawyer. I can be like the lawyer and say, I will always be on a self-justification program. It will always be about what I can do to earn God's love. What I can do to prove that I am good enough. What Jesus is saying through the parable is, we're all dead in our trespasses. We're all like the man lying half dead on the road. No one is good enough. No one can truly say, I love God with my whole heart, mind, soul, and strength. No one can say, I truly love my neighbor as myself. We've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. It's only by God's grace, by Jesus picking me up off the road, that I can be saved. All right, we need to understand that. Not just in our head, okay, but in our heart as well. That Jesus is the great Samaritan. Jesus is the one who grabs us, who picks us up. I am in spiritual poverty. Jesus is the one who comes and rescues me. That's the first thing that we need to understand. Because of that, there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. What a wonderful truth. What a wonderful truth. There's no condemnation, just like Steve was telling us. There's no condemnation. I've been saved through Christ. I didn't earn it. All right? Now, grace matters because grace then becomes the lens. Grace becomes the way I frame my attitude. Grace becomes my settled way of thinking about the rest of this. As I look in and I see what God has done for me, then and only then can I really look out and see the way I ought to view other people, how I ought to love my neighbor. Now, there are many ironies in the story that we'll get to, but I have to grasp that first principle that it's about grace, it's about the truth of Christ coming into my life, saving me, changing my perspective, helping me see differently other people. I can't do it on my own. All right, now, let's get into the way we perhaps see other people with grace as my lens. Now, second point. It's about justice. It's about justice. That's a great word, justice. What do we mean by justice? Justice has a lot of like emotional charge to it, doesn't it? All right? It's about justice. We care for the poor, the broken, and the marginalized, those on the edges of society. We care for the poor, the broken, and the marginalized. So I would challenge us to think this morning, okay, how do we think about justice? Now, nobody's in a vacuum here. We've all got a background. We've all got a story. We've all got experiences. All right, I would ask us this morning, how do we think about justice? All right, we care for the poor, the broken, and the marginalized. Now, let me give you the what, the why, and the how of justice. Okay, first of all, let's talk about the what. What do we mean by justice? Okay, Micah 6:8 says this, "And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, that's an action, and to love mercy, that's an attitude, and to walk humbly with your God." Okay, so justice is about an action, it's about an attitude. It's what I do, it's the way I think. Deuteronomy 10:17 and 18 says, "For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality and accepts no bribes. He defends the cause of the fatherless and the widow and loves the foreigner residing among you, giving them food and clothing, and you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt." Tim Keller talks about justice reflecting the heart of God. He, God, defends the cause of the fatherless and widow and loves the foreigner. That is the very heart of who God is. Now, what is also important to understand in this, justice for whom? Okay, Keller and others talk about the quartet of the vulnerable, the poor, the widow, the immigrant, and the orphan. Okay, the quartet of the vulnerable. How does our heart, what is our attitude towards those on the margins, those who are most vulnerable? Now, verse 19, "And you are to love those who are foreigners, for you yourselves were foreigners in Egypt." All right, I want you to think about that. Back at that same school, a long time ago, first year teaching, doing a Thanksgiving food drive. Have you ever done like food drive before, right? In school, students, you've done food drives, all right? And like if your class wins the food drive, you get like a donut party or something. Like Long's Donuts on the west side would come in and we'd have like donuts and kind of a big deal, right? So had this one kid in class, Chris. Never forget Chris. Had his head down most of the time in class. But when it came, I always have to wake him up. But when it came time for the food drive, Chris lit up. Every day, Chris would bring in money, like real money, not like a quarter, like a dollar. He'd bring in a 20. He'd bring in a 50 for the food drive. Some kid would go to Aldi. We'd buy a bunch of cans. We ended up winning the food drive, had our donut party. It was great. All right? And one day I asked Chris, I said, "Why? I mean, this is cool and all, but why are you giving that much money?" You know what Chris said? "I know what it means to be hungry." He says, "I know what it means to be hungry." Now, I think he had his head down the rest of the semester, but for that moment, Chris was the hero of the food drive. Why? Because he knew what it meant to be hungry. There's an identification here that is critical. There's an identification process here that is critical that we're going to get to when we talk about the why of justice. The why of justice. Keller says there are two reasons why we should do justice. Why we should care. The first he says is this, it's joyful awe before the goodness of God's creation. Wow. Genesis 1:26 says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness." My question this morning to me and to you is, do we truly see the person in need as made in the image of God? Do I truly see people that way? I know I always haven't. I always don't. I have to be reminded of that. I have to see that that person is made in the image of God. That can change my whole attitude, can it not? Do I truly see that individual as a unique creation made in the image of God? Second reason is the experience of God's grace in redemption. Now, let's work this out a little bit. Keller says it this way. He says, to the degree that the gospel shapes your self-image, the way you view yourself, your attitude, to the degree that the gospel, grace, I've been saved, it's not what I've done, I'm poor in spirit, spiritual poverty, I bring nothing, okay, I can't save myself, I'm not the lawyer on my self-justification project, all right? But the gospel, the good news that saves, shapes your self-image, you will identify with those in need. In other words, when Christians who understand the gospel see a poor person, they realize they are looking in a mirror. Now think about that. Process that just a minute. How does that work? I have to be able to put myself in the position. Okay, you may say, well, I don't have physical poverty. I don't have material poverty. I'm not on the mark, whatever, but I am a spiritual beggar. Okay? I have nothing that can save. It's only by God's grace that I am saved. When I see that, when I understand the gospel, when I see the poor person, I see the quartet of the vulnerable, I realize that I am looking in a mirror. Let that sink in a minute. Let that sink in a minute. Because the why matters. It matters to me. It's challenged my way of thinking. All right, do I see that other person as a child of God, as created in the image of God? Can I see the mirror? Do I see myself in the mirror? Do I understand what God's done for me and therefore how I should respond? Let's talk about the how. Proverbs 41:1 says, "Blessed is the man who considers the poor." Now, don't get thrown by the word considers and think, well, that just means think and don't do, all right? When you look at the Hebrew, considers means sustained attention and wise and successful action. All right, Steve always challenges us, pray and think hard. Okay, this is the thinking hard part. All right, are there effective and ineffective ways to help the poor? Absolutely. Are there complicated issues? Absolutely. Okay, but my attention needs to be focused. Job 29:14 says, "I put on righteousness as my clothing, justice was my robe and my turban." Now, I'm not saying put a robe on and put a turban on, okay? But we all get dressed every day, right? Is there any day that you don't get dressed? Well, we may have issues there, okay? But anyway, right? I am putting on clothing every day. I am putting on righteousness. I am putting on justice every day. It's not a check the box. Thanksgiving drives and all that are great, but do I have sustained thought? Is this an everyday thing that I am thinking about, that I am considering? Proverbs 31:8 says, "Speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute." And then James 2:15 through 17 says this, "Suppose a brother or sister is without clothes and daily food. If one of you says, 'Go, I wish you well, keep warm and well fed,' but does nothing about his physical needs, what good is it? In the same way, faith by itself, if it is not accompanied by action, is dead." Now, don't get tripped up here, okay? Do my works ever save me? No. Okay? Do all my good deeds and my kindness toward the poor, the marginalized, can that ever save me? No. I can never truly love God with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I can never truly love my neighbor as myself. I can never do enough to earn my salvation. However, okay, if I truly have received grace, if I truly understand that I am the dead man on the road, that Jesus has saved, that Jesus is rescued, that should change my heart. That should change my actions towards those who are most in need. What James is saying, if they don't have that change, I don't know if that change has really occurred. Okay? The works don't save us, but they're evidence. Okay? They're a sign. Okay? So I would take a hard look if I have complete indifference and apathy toward those most in need. James doesn't pull any punches, does he? Okay? Now, let's talk about diversity. Let's talk about diversity for just a minute. And we've said it this way in our code. We want our church to look more like God's kingdom. Now, Pastor Steve gave us a beautiful illustration of kind of unity and diversity at the table at communion. All right? Nothing about Pastor Steve, and he shared this a little bit ago with me and some of the staff, but his secret prayer when he got here, came to CCG 10, 11 years ago, was that one day we would be a church that looked more like God's kingdom. That we would be a church that would come closer to what Revelation 7, 9 says, "After this I looked," this is John, "I looked and behold a great multitude that no one could number from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages." Okay? We're not where we want to be, but we're not where we used to be. All right? And that secret prayer of Steve's is starting to come to some fruition. And we want to continue that. We want to continue to care about diversity. Okay? Now, here's where grace comes in. And we've got to see it this way, okay? This is all about how do I see, how do I change the way I see, how do I work through that. Galatians 3:28 says, "There is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." That gives us that New Testament feel of that. But let me go back to the book of Galatians and give you kind of this real concrete example. Okay, two of the big guns in the New Testament, Peter and Paul. Believe it or not, sometimes people in the church didn't get along. All right, now Peter, devout, you know, grew up devout Jew and everything, and if you were a devout Jew, you did not eat with the Gentile, the non-Jew. Okay, so you've got Jews and Gentiles both coming to Christ, and there's conflict. How do we interact? Okay, now, the teaching of the gospel was that those divisions didn't matter. There's one table, one bread, one body, all those things. But here's what happened with Peter. Peter was fine. He was eating with Gentiles and everything was cool. And then there was a group that was like ultra-conservative, follow the law to a T and all that, came into town, and all of a sudden Peter would no longer eat with the Gentiles. He wouldn't do that anymore. And Paul said to this behavior is not in line, is not in step with the gospel. It is not in line, it is not in step with the gospel. That was his point of correction. It was not in line with the gospel. Now, because part of what that thinking would be is my culture is superior. My culture is better than anybody else's. Okay? I am only going to stick to what I know. I am only going to associate with people who are just like me. Interesting, in this time, more so then, but to some extent now, the sharing of a meal is important, is it not? Okay. Isn't that a sign of community? Isn't that an important thing that says there is no longer a divide between us? Okay. I would challenge myself. I would look in the mirror. I would challenge you. Have you crossed that line? Okay. Have you eaten a meal with somebody outside your normal circle? Martin Luther King, way back in the day, Sunday morning was the most segregated hour, right, in America. All right? Strides have been made, all right? But that challenge, if I'm going to be in line with the gospel, maybe I need to cross that line and invite. Okay, and here's the other thing about diversity that kind of changed my thinking a little bit. Okay, and this is what the picture in Revelation gives us a little bit too. When we think about the church, a lot of times when we think about justice, we think justice for whom? The poor, the marginalized, the quartet of the vulnerable, and all those things. When we think about diversity, are there those of other ethnicities and races and all that that need help? Of course. But I want us to think about not just justice for whom, but justice, ministry, with whom? Okay, let that sink in for just a minute. As we build the church, as we help the church to be more like what God wants it to be, what it will someday be eternally, when we look at others, when we look at people who do not look, who have a different socioeconomic, whatever, different, any kind of diversity we can think of, am I asking the question, with whom am I serving? With whom am I doing ministry? Challenge me. All right? Now, so there's some things to think about, some things to see with diversity. Now, just remember this. The way I think about things, the way I grew up, my own background is not a monopoly on the truth, right? Okay? So let's see differently. All right? Now, the final challenge. It's about unity. It's about unity. Theologians out there, there's a cool thing with diversity and unity that reflects the very image of God. It's like for the advanced students, just ponder that, okay? Right? The Trinity, unity, diversity, all that stuff, really cool to think about. All right? It's about unity. What do we mean by unity? I'm going to give you kind of a different way of thinking about that. Steve gave us a great picture of unity. We're unified by our beliefs, who we are in Christ, all those things. I'm going to give you more of a process of unity, and this is in our code. Reconcile all relationships, go through the tunnel of chaos if you need to. Now, a lot of times we think about the tunnel of chaos, and Steve has really done a great job of challenging us on that, and that may be, you know, how do I reconcile conflict with a family worker, or a family member, a coworker, whatever. But I want us to think about this also in terms of the way I think. All right? Do I need to kind of go through the tunnel of chaos in how I see other people? Okay? Maybe there's some hard truths I need to think about. I need to reconcile. And I probably need help to do that. Okay, I love the challenge of Hebrews 10:24-25 says, and let us consider, love that word consider, how to stir up one another to love and good works. Now to stir up, the Greek, there's a little bit of pain in that. I mean, I got to kind of think hard. I've got to be challenged a little bit. All right, when you're in a small group, that's part of what we do in groups. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Steve was talking a little bit about that day, about doubling your influence, doubling your impact. All right, think about what you've been given, what I've been given. Who do you need to meet with? Who do you need to help think things through? Who in your life, Steve challenged us to think about being at the bottom of the well, but who can you look out to who can help you think through some of these issues? All right? Maybe there's some reconciliation in your own mind. Okay, we all come from different backgrounds and histories and all that kind of stuff, but don't assume that there's nothing there that you don't have to think through, okay? All right, now, as we bring this to a close, now what? What do I do? Three questions for you this morning. Three questions. Number one, what is my real attitude toward my neighbors? What is my real attitude toward my neighbors? What is my real settled way of thinking? What is my settled way of thinking? Two, how is my attitude reflected in my actions and my priorities? How is my attitude reflected in my actions and my priorities? Now, we're all busy. It's kind of the part of what defines our culture. Where is our concern for the quartet of the vulnerable? Where is our concern for diversity, for unity, for these things? Where does it fall on our priority list? Kind of interesting in the parable, it's the priest and the Levite who just pass on by. Too much work, too difficult, too dangerous. The gospel that saves, grace that saves, also challenges us to work for him who saved me. That's sacrifice. It's hard thinking. It's all those things. How is my attitude reflected in my actions and my priorities? What step can I take this week? What step, as we kind of wrap this up, and we're going to pray here in just a second, but what step can I take this week? All right? Now, maybe for some of you, it's a step of understanding grace. Okay, we'd love to help you understand that. Okay, if you've been on this kind of self-justification project, I can save myself, I've got to earn God's love, let us help you think through that. Okay, let us help you understand grace. Let us kind of guide you, help you see who God really is and what he's done for us. Okay, maybe for others of us, it's a step of justice. Okay, it's a step of justice. Got a buddy that works for a technology company that works with schools, and Normally they work with schools that are kind of middle upper class, and now they're working with a school that's primarily made up of refugees who don't speak English. Wow, what a challenge. What an opportunity to share God's grace and really make a difference with there. Okay? Somebody else says, wow, I want to help feed people. I'm going to start a community garden and give away those vegetables to the refuge or somebody. Wow, what a cool thought. All right? But I don't know what that step is for you. Maybe there's a step of, wow, I need to build a friendship. I need to have somebody over for dinner who's not in my circle. I don't know what that step is. We're going to ask the Holy Spirit to lead us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you for your grace. We thank you, Father, that while we were yet sinners, while we were dead on the road, you sent your Son to die for us. Holy Spirit, I ask now that you move in our hearts, you move in our minds, you help us to see you more clearly, and help us to see our neighbor more clearly, and help us to see our own attitude and our own next steps. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.